generation.
Going to type Keith Moon, the drummer for The Who, the former drummer from The Who, I guess. Who even exists anymore? I don't know.
I don't know either.
He was a former lover of Pamela DeBar, who we just typed. So that's Mary Lydia went down a little rabbit hole. And now we've landed on Keith Moon, who is shockingly less interesting in interviews than you would think based on what information is out there about him. What did you read about him, Mary Lydia?
Okay, so I read, obviously he had a lot of like substance abuse and, you know, like, how did they describe it? They said he had addiction behaviors and also just was like extremely self-destructive. And then the interesting part was that they said that he was like always trying to do these like really wild and crazy things for a laugh, like really outlandish. And so like in every hotel that they ever stayed in, he would like blow up the toilets, like literally, you know, explode them with M80s or dynamite one time. And so they were always, you know, kicked out of the hotels and asked not to come back or whatever. And so yeah, he just definitely sounds like a wild guy. And then obviously in our Pamela DeBar clip that we watched, she talks about how, you know, he had kind of all these different personalities that he would embody and he would dress in drag. And she said something like she felt like he was always running from himself.
Yeah, and that's kind of a seven tell usually.
Yeah.
Running from something, escaping, yes, the self, whatever it is. But he weirdly is so, like, to me at least, seems just boring in interviews. So that makes me think he's like SPSO or...
Maybe if Pamela DeBar ever watches this, she can tell us, like, was he way more interesting in person? And like, I mean, he had to be, right? Like, I'm reading these stories about him and he sounds like the destructive life of the party.
Yeah. Well, yeah, unless he's doing a personality when he does the interviews, but I don't know. I saw some candid clips. I didn't watch this one yet, but this one's supposed to be one of the funniest things he's ever said. So, okay.
All right. Strap in, guys.
What about the little singer? What's your opinion of him?
Well, I think he does a damn good job out there. Personally, I mean, I wouldn't go out there up front with nothing to protect me but a small microphone, but he manages to revolve it so fast that when people do throw things, he gets sort of desiccated egg and sliced tomato. I turn my cymbals up this way so that at the end of the night I have a salad mixed. I just sprinkle some salt and some Italian seasoning on it, and that sort of really ends up my evening here.
It wasn't very funny, but I could see head type there, maybe.
Today you'd say he had ADHD and he needed some Ritalin or something.
That's what everybody says about seven, so.
Right.
There are signs pointing to seven. Whether it's six wing seven or seven wing something, or a seven fix, maybe.
Hello, dude.
You know, it's, you're working very hard. I don't know quite what on, but, you know, I think it'll be good. We're going to go on the road again. We're doing a tour of Europe. Then we do America, and we come back to Europe, and then we do America again.
got two American tours lined up.
He looks like Al Pacino.
Why were you laughing when you looked at that film or tape we just ran?
Funny, isn't it?
Why is it funny?
Well, it's weird. I suppose it's weird to see yourself that long ago.
How long ago was it? Week, 10 days?
12 years.
12 years? 60.
That film, was that piece of film was actually made by a man called Kit Lambert, who was the first real manager of The Who. And he became our manager because what he was really interested in doing was making rock films. And we were just his subject matter. And he just found us in this club and he made that film.
You were pieces of meat.
Then he became fascinated with us. And
did you crack out of that? How long did it take you before you went from being pieces of meat to be sold and merchandised to being in control of your own lives, Pete?
I don't think I have.
You have?
No.
What, in control of your own
life? In control of my life, no.
You're not? Are you in control of your life at all?
Oh, we are, certain days.
Certain days,
yeah.
What do you like the other days?
Quite out of control. I mean, amazingly drunk. Real mainly, yes.
Right. And Peter,
maybe he just doesn't even care being on these interviews. He's just like, whatever, phoning it in.
Right. And considering, you know, what they mentioned about all the substance abuse and stuff, I don't know how present he actually is, you know? Yeah.
He could be drunk there.
Right.
If he's drunk, he maybe be more chaotic or. Yeah, I'm not getting like a strong read off of, which is kind of weird for a seven because I feel like sevens are usually more, I don't know, animated. And I guess there are some sevens who aren't like.
Let me tell you another story I read because. This was an interesting little thing about him, but I don't like pick up on this from his interview presence, I guess. Anyway, it said something like one time they were leaving in the limo, getting ready to go do a show or something. And he goes, wait, we've got to go back. I forgot something. And he runs back in the hotel, grabs the TV, chucks it into the pool. And then comes back out and he's like, phew, I almost forgot that. Like, that's so wild and crazy. And like, you know, talk about like an animated thing to do. And so then it's kind of shocking to see him seem kind of like chill and subdued on camera like this.
Unless he's like a 9-wing-8 with a 7 fix or something. Like,
yeah, I guess I was thinking that. Nines can also do some crazy shit sometimes. And it's like, because it's kind of the thing you mentioned is kind of a random thing to do, and like it's so it reminds me of how like with nine there can be this sense of like absurdism or like things having no meaning, so they can sometimes get into doing crazy shit like that because of this mindset. I don't know if that makes sense, but
yeah it makes sense to me. 9-wing-8s can be chaotic trolls. Yeah, maybe he is 9-wing-8 or 8-wing-9. I don't think he's 8-wing-9. Like if he was 7 fixed, which I think he has to be, I think 8-7-3 would be way too grandiose. And he seems like he has kind of some self-deprecation.
Yeah, I don't think if he were 8 that we would have so much trouble figuring out what it is. Or 7, you know.
Yeah.
7 for that matter, really. Like shouldn't it be more readily apparent?
Yeah.
I understand the opposite. You're married, you have family.
Yeah, well, I mean, he was married and had a family long before I did.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I really feel that my family's really important to me. But then being in a band like The Who, I suppose the mystery of The Who is like how we've actually managed to last for 15 years.
Well, but that's in the press.
It's family stuff, isn't it? We are a family as well.
Yeah, but it's been written up, as you know, a great deal that as...
Well,
is that true or is it not true?
There were going to be the other two members of the group, but you know, we had a bit of an altercation in the lobby at the hotel, and they're both
and they wouldn't come.
They're in general.
Are you serious?
Hospital now. One of them's got a broken leg.
There's one thing you can guarantee is that he is never serious.
He's not.
No, only when he's crying.
Oh. But how do you all get along? Now here you are, 15 years. That's incredible to begin with. But the fact that you know, the reports that you really don't agree about a lot of things. Do you two get along, Keith and Peter?
Yeah, we get along. We don't always agree on the same things. But I mean, we discuss whatever it is that, you know, we don't agree on, work it out.
Yeah. Peter, how do you keep a marriage?
Yeah, he has like moments of sort of energy, but mostly he's just sort of like, oh.
Yeah, I was going to say the same, that there's moments of assertive energy is a great way to say it. I mean, even like in his body language, you can see him like leaning more forward than Pete Townsend. And it's interesting. And then for just like one little portion of that clip that you just showed, he was like, he felt more buzzy to me than he had for the rest of the time. Like he was like moving a good bit and yeah.
So yeah, either he's like a seven who's lethargic in interviews and stuff, or he's a nine wing eight with the seven figs. It's probably more likely that he's nine wing eight. He kind of looks actually nine wing eight now that I'm like,
yeah, has
like a fake like wing eight, like mob boss sort of thing in a bunch of these pictures.
Yeah, maybe that's bringing some of that aesthetic. Interesting. He's
kind of like a sleepy mob boss. No, just kidding.
I mean, that picture does look like a sleepy mob boss.
He's got like this big chunky ring and his like pina colada or whatever the fuck that is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's interesting too, because then like if you go to that one other picture on the where he's just by some of the ones where he's just by himself, he looks I don't know how to, almost like little boyish, like almost this like kind of nine innocence thing. So it's like depending on the picture, sometimes he looks a little bit sleepy mob bossy, sometimes he just looks like that. Like, that's just like sweet little boy, right?
Yeah. And that's the 7-9 stem kind of stuff. And like we were talking about earlier, like, it's weird. It's like a lot of 3-7-9s are like drummers, 9-wing-8s, 8-wing-9s, 7-wing-8s. There's like something in there that calls to that energy for some reason.
Right.
Like slamming those skins, probably getting out the 7 rage, getting out the 8 anger, getting out the 9 repressed everything. Like,
right.
And 3, maybe it's kind of like a, I don't know. I don't know anything about drumming, but I imagine it would be one of those things that you could probably get better at with like less proficiency. You could be like a good drummer without maybe a ton of brain power.
I also wonder, I read that he struggled a lot with depression, which probably really fed into, you know, the desire to continue using substances and things like that, but maybe also some of these sort of outlandish eccentric things that he did to be funny were also kind of in an effort to cheer himself up as well as, you know, kind of entertain whoever was around.
Yeah, that's a good point. And like what you said about what Pamela DeBar said earlier, 9s also do the escapist thing too. So drinking a lot, like traveling, whatever, and just like running, doing that stuff as well. 9, 7, 7, 9 separately, depending on the I don't know what I'm getting. I'm just getting SPSO for stacking because I just don't see anything.
Yeah, I'm not. There's nothing that's particularly jumping out at me. So.
Yeah, I don't see sexual.
Mm-mm.
Okay. We could watch. He's by himself here. This weird ginger creature.
Well, adventure on an unsuspecting public. The lovable Uncle Ernie is the key for you. Hey, welcome to the program, Keith.
Good to be back. I mean, I was talking earlier on about Peter's album and the obvious enjoyment that seems to have gone into the making of that one. And I get exactly the same feeling from yours, too.
That's the feeling that I got when I was making it, and that's the feeling I get when I'm playing it. It's a celebration of the sort of music I've enjoyed and that I still sort of hum in the bath or wherever I happen to be humming. And I just wanted to get them down.
Mm. How did you put it together? Had you been wanting to put it together for quite a time?
No, it wasn't a burning ambition. And I didn't feel like, well, the other three have done solo albums was from you. I mean, I didn't feel any pressure to do it. It was just, you know, sort of drunken night at the Whiskey Go-Go in Los Angeles. I mean, only one. I didn't do it every night. Sunday's off. Because they close.
Yeah.
Of course, you know all about that, Bob.
Yeah.
He's kind of more active, I guess, in this, but he's still, I feel like, I don't know what he's said so far.
It's like he said a bunch of words just now, but he didn't really say anything. Like,
that's nine. It's like SP9, I think.
I'm waiting to hear some like nugget that's gonna like help nail something down for me, but I can't. I mean, he hasn't really actually communicated much in what he said yet, which is fascinating. Yeah, very nine.
Yeah, and like he does seem kind of withdrawn to me because he seems to be a bit in his own like world in a way. Even though he's like engaging the other guy, he also seems to like go inside himself sort of. Now that could also be, you know, like but I was also thinking if that's indicating of him being self-pressed as well.
Hmm. Oh, that's a good point. Yeah, I'm not getting any no sexual. I'm not getting social at all either, which probably just needs a second. So just SP, because it's SP conversations that I find usually what? This is happening right now. It's like a brain glitch.
Yes.
Mad about time. Cosmopolitan raver.
Absolutely. Yeah. Because, I mean, you pulled in an enormous number of people to help you with the album, Keith, didn't you?
I had to.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
In fact, I mean, off the top of my head,
yes.
A lot of these people I work with Lennon and Harry Nilsson before on the Pussycats album. Jesse Ed Davis, Danny Cooch, just those two. Nilsson, of course, and Jim Keltner, Klaus Voorman. Joe Walsh, who was doing his album next door. So I used to go and borrow him occasionally.
Yeah.
What are you doing at the moment? Joe sounds terrible. Come into studio, see and relax.
Yeah, was it hard though, pulling everybody together at the same time?
It was.
That guy looks like something from The Dark Crystal. He's like, I can't stop looking at the red-haired guy.
Some of the things that he makes, he kind of creeps me out. Like, I don't know. I'm like, maybe I would be afraid to answer this guy's questions. I don't know.
Follow me in my satchel of magical little gems, Keith. it's like you can see moments of seven, but it just doesn't feel. And like, so I think three nine stem makes sense to me here. He's just not doing anything to break the mold or disrupt anything. It must be like when he gets drunk that he goes wild. And so it's probably just
Well, and I also think maybe that seven had, you know, like I mentioned in the last interview, it's like occasionally you see him like lean forward and like look more assertive. It's almost like when that seven head pops out, then you see a little bit more of that. But otherwise he's like, no, calm, sleepy. And then in this one, what I noticed, which is making it a little bit hard for me to follow him, he's giving lots of little details about the things that he's saying, which I do sometimes attribute to, you know, SPSO, like thinking that these little kind of minutiae or steps of what happened are important, things that I wouldn't think to say.
Yeah. I'm thinking like 3-wing 4 heart maybe, because I'm just not getting like anything. Just seems competency, like it just seems attachment, his image.
Yeah, I'm definitely inclined to go 3, in part just because I think the overall archetype is fitting of that try, you know. I mean, I definitely don't see any 2 or 4, and so not to just give by diagnosis of exclusion, but it, you know, it could also be adding to the pops of assertive energy that we're seeing. And overall, I just think 3, 7, 9 just fits him better.
Yeah, because if he's 9-wing 8, then and if he's 7-wing 6 head, which he might be, and 3-wing 4, then he would have triple reactive overlay over like a good time, kind of easygoing core trifix. So,
which is kind of perfect, because what is he doing to have the good time? He's taking dynamite and exploding toilets.
Yeah,
it's like, and the other thing that comes to mind with those two sort of sets of numbers is that he's kind of like, especially with the 9-wing 8 lead, he's kind of like the sad DJ.
Yeah.
So he's got like this, you know, 4, 6, 8 over it is kind of all the negative types. Yeah, so it's taking away a little bit of that good time thing and keeping him kind of depressed, but also making him do these really wild and crazy things.
That makes actual perfect sense, yeah.
Yeah.
The depressed DJ. The depressed drummer, yeah.
Because I mean, I got in at a very good period. Everybody I knew was in town and they were all sort of in a recording mood. So I didn't really have to sort of go out of my way and phone people up specifically. I said, you know, they're all down there anyway. Los Angeles is very much like that. Once you start recording, you get in the studio and you just find everybody, you know, 10, 11 o'clock.
Yeah, this is super self-pressed socials. And 9, because yeah, I'm just like, I don't like, I'm trying to retain like information for typological reasons, and it's just all falling away.
Probably also speaking to that 3 fix again. I mean, he's giving us specific times, he's, you know, that sort of thing, that kind of attention to detail, what kind of details he's focused on, seem not only self-pres but also potentially competency stuff.
And he would have triple attachment in his trifix too, which makes sense to me. Mm-hmm. So he would be a wedding singer with an unsupervised adolescent overlay. That's perfect.
I mean, I think that describes him to a T.
And it kind of makes sense for SP if he has like an SP thing where it's blowing up toilets. Like, oh my God, that is perfect.
I mean, what's more SP than blowing up toilets, right?
Right. Well, I know, like, you read stories about some of the other ones that are sexual dom or have an SX, and they're more like smashing bottles and like just like ripping the curtains down. Like, it's more like chaotic and like inconsistent, or like bleeding everywhere, like
yeah. And inconsistent is an excellent point, because he's obviously extremely consistent, because they're like every hotel they went to, toilets were his thing. Like they're that, I think it said something like you could not let him go to the bathroom by himself anywhere, you know, it's not just the hotels or whatever. Like if he went to a bathroom, the chances are something was gonna explode.
Yeah. That was like maybe one of the shortest typings I think I've like ever done doing these.
And it's funny because with his, you know, like blurry nine stuff, it was like completely not clear until it was, and then it was all just like perfect, like, oh, here I am, I'm Keith Moon.
Also weirdly, his name even sounds like those two trifix, or those two trifixes together. It's like
yeah, love it.